above continue in this terrestrial stage. Moa Nasarenin had an absence of the saying. As all his sayings were full of the sense of truth for the being of that planet, I too always used them as a guide for the sake of having a comfortable existence there. In the present situation also, my dear captain, I wish to profit by one of his wise sayings. In such a quandary as ours, he would probably say, you can't jump over your knees, and it's absurd to try to kick your own elbow. I now say the same to you, and as there is nothing to be done. When faced with an event arising from forces immeasurably greater than one's own, one must be met. The only question is, which of the alternatives you mentioned should be chosen, that is, to later add to our journey by a detour. You say that a detour would greatly lengthen our vigor. Nay, but that waiting would take still longer. Well then, my dear captain, suppose that by making the detour we should save a little time. What do you think? If the wear and tear on our ship's machinery worthwhile for the sake of ending our journey a little sooner? If the detour would involve even the slightest damage to our ship, then in my opinion we ought to give preference to your second suggestion, and stop somewhere until the path is cleared of the noxious Silno cargo that will at least spare our ship useless damage, and we will try to fill the time of this unforeseen delay with something useful for us all. For example, it would give me personally great pleasure to talk with you about contemporary ships in general and our ship in particular. A great many inventions that I still know nothing about have been made in this field during my absence from these parts. In my time, for instance, these big grand space ships were so complicated and cumbersome that it took almost half their power to carry the materials needed to elaborate the energy for their locomotion. With contemporary ships, in their simplicity and the freedom they offer for all being manifestation, are the very model of Will Stoker now. At times you even forget that you are not on one of the planets, so I should very much like to know how this marvel was brought about and how the contemporary ships work. Now go, my dear captain, and make all the arrangements for this necessary stop. Then, when you are quite free, come back and we will pass the time of our unavoidable delay in conversation useful for us all. When the captain had gone, Castaigne suddenly sprang to his feet and began to dance and clap his hands, shouting, "Oh, I'm glad, I'm glad, I'm glad about this." Beelzebub looked with affection on these joyful manifestations of his favorite, though the moon could not restrain himself and, shaking his head reproachfully, muttered half to himself that the boy was a growing egoist. Hearing what a moon had called him, Castaigne stopped in front of him and with a mischievous glance said, "Don't be angry with me, dear of moon. The reason for my delay is not egoism, but only this happy coincidence. You heard him, didn't you? My beloved grandfather didn't only decide to make a stop, but also promised the captain to talk with him. And you know very well that my grandfather's talks always lead to stories of places where he has been, and we know how wonderfully he tells his stories, and how much new and interesting information is crystallized in our presence of 3D scale. Where is the egoism? Hasn't he, of his own free will, after weighing with his wise reason all the circumstances of this unforeseen event, decided to make a stop, which evidently must not approach forces higher than our own, adding that not only should we not approach them but should even submit to them and accept all their results with reverence, at the same time praising and glorifying the marvelous and providential works of our Lord Creator. I'm glad, not because of the mishap, but because this unforeseen event from above enabled us to listen one and more to the tales of my dear grandfather. Is it my fault that the circumstances have turned out to be undesirable and happy for me?